Welcome to the second session of the Shaping Young Minds program with Mr. Vineet Agarwal, Managing Director, Transport Corporation of India Limited, as the speaker, and Mr. Dhruba Mukherjee, Vice President, The Telegraph, and past President, CMA, as a session moderator. Before we request our dignitaries to be seated on the dais, I would request the 8 student panelists to please be seated on their respective seats on the stage. It is my proud privilege to invite on stage Mr. Vineet Agarwal, the speaker of the second session, and Mr. Dhruba Mukherjee as a session moderator. Before I hand over the proceedings to Mr. Mukherjee, few words about him. Mr. Dhruba Mukherjee joined ABB Group in 1997 and currently holds SBU responsibilities for the telegraph and the radio business of the group. He had joined as a management trainee and in the last 18 years has worked on the Anandabajar Potrika brand, circulation sales for dailies and the telegraph brand before taking over his current responsibilities. He is a BCom honours from St. Xavier's College, Calcutta, MBA from IIS WBM under Calcutta University, and is also an alumnus of the London School of Economics and Political Science. I now hand over the proceedings to Mr. Mukherjee and request him to introduce Mr. Agarwal and take the program forward.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for those generous words and a kind introduction, as usual. And a very, very warm welcome to all of you to the second session of the day. I know the first session, as it should be, started off on a classical note. And hopefully we will get into more modern music in this session. And you'll probably start enjoying. On the stage, you know, there's a very interesting contrast on the stage as we start this session. And I think it's important to point it out as we roll over with the session, because it will come again and again in the context of the topic that we want to discuss. And so you see two individuals out here who are what people call from the millennial generation. You know, one individual who is bald and the other is beautiful. So one is Mr. Agarwal and one is myself. And you see 8 other individuals on the stage who probably come from the post-millennial generation, or some people affectionately call it Generation Z or Z, depending on which part of the ocean you are. And this is the conflict that corporate world is seeing or going to see going forward, the conflict between the millennial and the post-millennial. And it's people like Vineet and me who have no doubt in our mind that the post-millennial, when they join the organization, which is you guys, you bring in a tremendous amount of skill set which probably we'll never be able to match. You're far ahead of time in terms of the skills that you bring to the workforce and to the table. And that's why probably people like us who are there in Aima have designed this session and chose a kind of an area where probably we'll be able to match you or probably guide you, and that's shaping minds. Because, you know, shaping skills is probably beyond our domain at this stage of the generation conflict. So this session is all about, shaping minds, where I feel, you know, as we go along and discuss and probably with your Q&A, we'll be able to help you in certain areas which we feel are your Achilles heel, are your weaknesses, which is in terms of focus and in terms of patience. You are a generation in a hurry, and probably we would like to step back and, you know, talk to you in terms of how we can shape your minds in that hurried journey that you're taking. And to do that today, we have with us a speaker who himself has probably walked the talk. And it is my proud privilege to introduce to you the speaker for the day, which is Mr. Vineet Agarwal. He's the Managing Director of Transport Corporation of India, one of India's largest logistics companies. I'm sure most of you are aware of that. He graduated from Carnegie Mellon University, and also from the Owner-President Management Program from Harvard Business School. Mr. Agarwal is currently serving on the International Board of Directors of Young Presidents Organization, member of Governing Council, Aima, All India Management Association, member of Logistics Committee, National Retail Committee, and National FMCG Committee of CII, and as a member, Logistics and Supply Chain Council, at the World Economic Forum. He was also awarded as the Young CEO of the Year 2014 by CEO India magazine and is involved in various social work through his family's foundation. You know, till now when you hear this introduction, I'm sure he comes across as a very intimidating guy to you who's done so many things in life. So let me de-intimidate you by sharing certain things which he told me and certain things which I gather from the professional world. One, he started, I would say, his journey from Calcutta. That's what he shared. His initial schooling, few years at least, was in Don Bosco Park Circus. So he is, like many of you and me, a Calcutta boy. And we Calcuttans just appropriate anything, anybody who has a trace anywhere in Calcutta as a Calcutta boy. So we proudly kind of affectionately refer to him as a Calcutta boy. Then on, he moved on to Delhi. But he's also an avid reader, and don't think that it's only serious books that he has read. I think I've read somewhere in a BW interview which he gave that he's grown up reading Hardy Boys and Amar Chitra Katha also. So it's also like you and me. Having said that, I'm also told one of his guiding lights, one of the books which continues to guide him, is the Vedanta Treatise by Swami Parthasarathi. So probably, you know, in his talks we'll find traces of that, which we'll look forward to. And he was asking us how long does it take from here to the airport. Then he didn't look too much worried when we told him 1.5 to 2 hours, maybe. That's simply because that even if the car fails, he's an avid marathon runner. So he can cover distances with a lot of stamina and vigor in a very, very short time. So that again is, I would say, the personal side of Mr. Vineet Agarwal. But on the professional side, beyond all what he's done, I think one of the traits which stood him out and made him such a achiever in a very short span of his life was he always probably able to predict the future and stay ahead of the game. So in his own company, when everybody was talking about logistics and transportation, he moved into supply chain because he felt that's where the future lies, and hence he was a step ahead of the competition and step ahead of the industry in a way, in trying to push through the supply chain management system instead of just a mere logistics and a transportation business that he inherited. So ladies and gentlemen, before I hand over to him, you know, a couple of ground rules for any session that I moderate, unlike ground rules in any other session, is please keep your mobile phone in the loudest mode possible so we can hear whose phone is ringing. That's one. If you don't find the session interesting enough, please do Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, whatever you want to. If not, of course, you can always pay attention if you find the session interesting enough. And I know that, you know, our generation was a smoker generation, so every 30 minutes to 40 minutes, people needed to take a smoke. Whereas your generation is more of a selfie generation, so every 15 to 20 minutes, you need to take a selfie. Right? So let's start, I think, by quenching your thirst for a selfie. So all of you take your mobile phone out and take a selfie. Come on, take it out. Let's finish that off at the beginning. Instead of you trying to do it secretly and all that, take it out. Let's see the phones. I'm sure all of you have a mobile phone. Yeah? India's penetration on mobile phone is very high. Take it out. Take a selfie and immediately post it to Facebook saying, attending Aima's Shaping Young Minds program with Vineet Agarwal and Dhruba Mukherjee, and then add a line, profound, and that's it. Right? Then at the end of the session, look at how many likes you've got, and that will tell you your social media score. And we will interact on that. So while you do that, I'll hand over the proceedings. Let Mr. Agarwal complete his selfie. I'll do when I go back. Right? So all of you done. So over to you, Mr. Agarwal. Okay, one more. I think he's taking a groofy on both sides. So that's okay. That's a new one. Right? Great. So over to you. Please welcome. Put your hands together and welcome Mr. Agarwal.
Good afternoon, friends. after hearing Aman and Ayan over here sing and, you know, just wow you guys, I thought I'll have to start dancing so that I could keep your attention. Otherwise, listening to another businessman speak might get boring after some time. So I'm not going to dance. We can do that at some other point. But nevertheless, I also love to dance apart from reading. and running marathons. So they're all correlated in many ways. I am a Calcutta boy. I was born here in Calcutta many decades ago. And I went to Don Bosco Park Circus. Some of you have been there, Don Bosco Park Circus? So, but that was only for the first 3 years of my life. And then I moved to Delhi. And there I went to DPS Arkipuram. Anyone from DPS? Okay, a few guys. So that was quite a shift from Calcutta. But both these schools, as you know, are extremely rigorous. They are one of the toughest schools in possibly the country. So that helped me a lot in terms of my education base and background. And but I didn't leave just the education part. I used to do a lot of other things there in colleges, in school, drama, sports, and because I sort of believe that it's not just education, but the education of the entire mind, body, and spirit that's important. Without that, I cannot grow. Right after that, I went to the US for my undergrad, which was at Carnegie Mellon University. This was in 1992, and I decided once I got there, after a year or two, that I wanted to do a lot more than what I was studying, and I was studying in just industrial management. So I added two more majors to my coursework. I did economics as well as something called social decision sciences. So I finished in 3.5 years and finished with a triple major. As well as did work there also. I was in the school newspaper as a photographer. I started a newsletter. Again, trying to keep that same spirit of, you know, same idea of keeping the mind, body, and spirit always active and always learning. apart from that, as soon as I came back from the US, my family, which is into the business of transportation and logistics, I got into that right away. And just I'll give you a short background about the family as well. My grandfather started this business in 1958, in fact, from Calcutta. He started off as just one man, one office, and one truck. He borrowed a lot of money to start that business. But because of his strong ethics and business principles, that he became very successful. And today the company is from that one man, one office, one truck, we have 1,400 offices and about 26,000 people that are working in the organization. And then my father and his brothers grew the business also. And I also, once I joined the business in 1996, I realized that there's a lot of things that can be done now, especially with the economy moving faster and just the changes that are coming. So we transformed our business a lot, and we now into even things like if you guys, how many of you order online? Almost everyone. So at the back end, we do a lot of the logistics for companies like Amazon and other online retailers. We do the warehousing, we do the packaging, and even the delivery to your homes for those packages. So it's a very, very fun business because we are always making things move. So when I joined the business, one of the most important things that I was pushed into doing by my father was that go and discover the country. So we had that time about 1,000 offices across the country. So I was traveling 20, 25 days in a month. And I'm assuming a lot of you are going to embark on a management journey now, right? How many of you are getting into a management job or expecting to get into a management job right after graduation? So almost everyone. So, and in that experience of that traveling of 25 days in a month, loading trucks, I used to be in the branches, in the hub centers in the night, getting trucks loaded, ensuring that they're leaving on time, traveling to small locations in the country. It was like what Jawaharlal Nehru wrote, his discovery of India. It was my discovery. The places I went to, the small places, I found out what grows where, what is produced where, even where the country's largest mosquitoes are found. So it was just an exhilarating experience, spending that, I think about 9 months without even a desk, even though coming from a family business, that's the first thing that's assumed. And then subsequently, I got into the business and started doing, getting into all kinds of new stuff that was coming in, more in terms of technology, in terms of marketing, in terms of what are the trends that are there, which are going to affect you and me as individuals in the field of logistics. Many things we do not realize and we take it for granted, but logistics is at the back of it. Your milk that comes in the morning, your bread that comes in the morning, your fruits and vegetables, your education that is happening to you wherever you are, your, of course, I'm not talking just about your physical movement, but all kinds of activities that are happening at the back end is because of an efficient logistics system. It is now predictable also. So, you know, when you've ordered a package online, you can actually track it and see, acha, you know, it's here. And then you know it's when it is reaching. They're sending you messages as arriving today. So what all that is because some backend in terms of logistics is working very efficiently to get that information to you. So in this 20 years of our journey, my journey in the management field, I've learned a lot. And our company went through lots of ups and downs, but we decided to change the trajectory of the company by doing and taking some bold decisions. We started professionalizing a lot. In fact, to that extent that we started off with one business, but now we have six businesses. And each of these businesses are run by CEOs. We, as family members, are not actively participating in any part of the business on a day-to-day basis, only at the strategic level. To that extent, my family members, the three of us that are in the business, my father, my younger brother and I, we don't even sign a single check in the company. So it's everything is left to professionals to run and manage the company. We changed our mindset. So we now recruit close to 75 to 100 people from MBA universities, colleges every year. So the entire culture of the company has changed in the last 20 years. In fact, we recruit from some of the colleges that you guys are at, Army Institute, I think at IIS, WBM, etc. So, and we have a lot of my colleagues are from the same places where you go to school. And this journey has been very rewarding because when the company, about 20 years ago, the value of the company was about 20 crores on the market in the stock exchange. And today that value is 2,500 crores. And what has happened because of that? In the last several years, we started rewarding employees with employee stock options as shares of the company. Because we believe that if we have to grow as an organization, the people working in the organization also have to grow. They also should get the rewards of their labor. And hence, we started giving out ESOPs. And amazingly, that those ESOPs have done phenomenally well for a lot of employees. In fact, to that extent, a lot of employees have actually started, have built their homes, have got their kids married. It has transformed the nature of how we do business in the country. But simultaneously, we also felt that we cannot just leave the other people behind who are helping us in that business. So, and who are those guys? They're perhaps the truck drivers, the laborers, the people who are also helping us grow. So we started a very big program with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to educate truck drivers on HIV/AIDS. And this was the world's largest program, which we started about 12 years ago. And we could actually bring down the incidence of AIDS in truck drivers. So it had to go beyond just the employees, and then the next level. And now what we are also doing is building India's first rural sports academy. So this is coming out in a remote village in Rajasthan where we are trying to promote non-traditional sports, not cricket, not football, not hockey, but you know, things like, now that you know, for example, wrestling, boxing, archery, and even running for that matter. Because we feel that those are the things that India should aspire to get a medal. And that's what my dream of my father is. So I'll talk to you about a little bit about what my specific learnings are, and then of course when we get into Q&A, we can talk more about it. So one is, always have a learning mindset. I'll just give you three. So one is, always have a learning mindset. And how do you ensure that? You will be thrown at different things in your life. You will be thrown at a job which is very demanding. You will be asked, you will be raising a family. You will have aging parents. You will have your heart broken. You will have a very horrible boss. But when all of this is happening, do not forget to keep a mindset of learning. Always keep thinking that I will not lose my ethics. You will be dragged into places where you will question your ethics. But do not let that happen. Always keep your mind focused on, I have to learn from this experience. I'm willing to try out any experience, but I will learn from this experience. I will keep my compass in the right direction. So, and how do you do that? The first way to do that is actually be self-aware. So, and how do you build self-awareness? So, there's a lot of ways. Every time you, what you should think about doing is do a SWOT analysis of your own self. Everyone knows what's a SWOT analysis? Yes. So every few years, have a diary and do a SWOT analysis. What are my strengths and weaknesses? And what do I see as opportunities and threats? And do that every few years and you will see how self-aware you will start becoming. Meditate. There are some apps. There's an app called Headspace. I don't know if you've used it. But it's very simple. Just download it and meditate. 10 minutes of meditation will have a huge impact on how you think about self-awareness. And always be authentic to your value system. Don't try to pretend. If you have a certain value system, keep that upfront. Always be authentic to that. The second way to do, to be have a learning mindset is be a knowledge taker. So what is a knowledge taker? So education is something that is given to you. Learning is what you do to yourself. So there's a big difference between education and learning. So there's a difference also between something called gyan and vigyan. Gyan means, does anyone know? Knowledge. So it's knowledge given. And vigyan is not technology, but vigyan is knowledge taken. So, and I can cite a small example from Vedanta where Dhruba just mentioned. In the Gita, there are lots of players in the Gita. You know of Arjun and Krishna who are actually having this conversation, right? What is the Gita? It's a conversation between two people who are talking about life in general. So they are the people who are the speakers, but who is transmitting that knowledge to someone else? There's a person in the middle called Sanjay, who's transmitting that conversation. He's viewing that conversation and transmitting it to someone called Dhritarashtra, who is the listener. So there are three elements here: the speaker, the transmitter, and the listener. So if you are a knowledge taker, and just not just getting knowledge, you will see that you will be in the first frame of reference, which is with Arjun and Krishna. Not in that last frame of reference, which is Dhritarashtra, which is just listening. So always keep that in mind, that I want to be a knowledge taker. And I just don't want to receive knowledge. And that will ensure that you will always have a learning mindset. And I do that to myself also. How do I do it? So I keep trying to learn new things all the time. So one of the things I do about books, for example, is I try to read two books a month. One is a fiction and one is a non-fiction. So I have a theory that if you are reading two books in a month, let's say you read for 60 years of active reading, you're going to read under 1,500 books in your lifetime. So you don't want to read crap. You have to focus on what to read. And that brings you to the point of, you're a knowledge taker. You're seeking what you want to read. And and hence you will have a learning mindset. So be focused in terms of what you're trying to absorb, be it from even from podcasts or from books or other sources of knowledge. The other point is always be intensely networked. So what does that mean? It means that do I need to go and meet people all the time? Do I need to attend parties? Do I need to talking to people and be an extrovert? No, you don't need to do that. Today you have means like Facebook, LinkedIn and other such sources where you can be intensely networked, but you're still not upfront. So do not forget that, because that will also help you to learn. You are absorbing what other people are doing, are saying. So that was my first point that is related to having a learning mindset. The second is change constantly. Even your previous speakers also talked about that. Fundamentally, do not ever change your values and culture. Change yourself continuously, but do not change your value system. Something that your parents and your how you've grown up with those value systems, do not change that. But change yourself on a continuous basis, on a regular basis. Do not have any fixed belief systems, because everything is changing. Today, the whole concept of even, I just talked about networking, that has changed. Look at the way how business is being done. You have the top five companies in the world with the highest market capitalization are not the brick and mortar companies. They are more technology companies. And some are companies like Google, etc., who really do not have even a product which is physical. So things have changed, and so those do not live in those fixed value systems. And I have a very nice quote that I quite often refer to, and this is by a Sufi poet called Rumi. Many of you might have heard about him. He said that, yesterday I was clever, so I wanted to change the world. Today I am wise, so I want to change myself. So be aware that you want to change yourself on a continuous basis. The third point after learning mindset, changing yourself continuously or constantly, the third is discipline. Anything that you do, do not forget about discipline. You cannot be indisciplined with any activity that you're doing. You have to respect the activity. You have to respect that idea that you are involved and you're doing something specifically. So I can cite the example of a marathon. When I started training I used to do half marathons three, four half marathons a year. A half marathon is about 21 kilometers. A full marathon is about 42 kilometers. So the discipline that was required for doing a 42 kilometers is very different from doing a 21 kilometers. The discipline was, I had to wake up at 5:30 in the morning or 5 in the morning. I think it was 4:35 in the morning and go to the park. I used to be the first person in the park. And I used to run for 2.5 hours, 3 hours continuously. And I used to be the last person out from the park every morning. And that was a discipline necessary. I remember 1 week before, or rather 2 weeks before training for actually running the full marathon, I actually ran 100 kilometers in about three to four days, because that's the only way I could train myself. And that is a discipline required, and it comes not by doing something at one shot, but by doing it continuously at smaller steps. And there's a very nice, again, a very nice saying by Martin Luther King, that if I cannot do great things, I can do small things in a great way. So that's the discipline that is necessary if you really need to succeed. And we always try to emulate ourselves with the West. A lot of you are going to join MNC companies. What is different between an MNC company and an Indian company? Lots of things. But what does the MNC company culture, what do they bring in? They absolutely bring in the the fact that you will be always looking at the ethics systems, okay, the work ethics. Every MNC company, you will say they will ensure that you are reaching to work at 9 o'clock, and they will ensure that you will go only when the work is done. So that ethics, the work ethics in a MNC company, which is essentially the West, is something you should definitely abide. But you should have the work commitment of an Indian company, the long-term thinking of an Indian company. So I know many friends who worked in MNC companies. In fact, one of my best friends actually graduated from IIM Calcutta in the 90s. And he worked for a lot of MNC companies. And he said that if they have to, there's no commitment there in the long term. If they find that this activity is not happening, they will eliminate you. But the work ethics that they have are far superior. So imbibe both these things. And that can only come with a lot of discipline. So that's all I had, the three things to talk about. One was a learning mindset. The second was to change constantly. The third was discipline. And I will end with a quote from one of my superheroes. His name is Batman. Many of you have heard about him. So I don't just read Amar Chitra Katha and Batman and comics. And he said, it is not who I am underneath, but what I do that defines me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vineet. I think it was short, crisp, and very, very enlightening. I think we were very focused to 3 points and 3 takeaways. And I think, you know, we all love sessions where we have key takeaways to take back, because often we have a rambling discourse and we really didn't know what to take out of it. But I think you kept it very focused and pointed. And we'll start with the Q&A session with you guys. Since there is very little of left in West Bengal, I'll start with my left and move to the right. Right. So we can start from the extreme left. I'd request you to introduce yourself and then ask your question. And once they're done, we'll come back to you and we'll open the house up, subject to time, for a few questions from any one of you, both from the top or down there.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Yashashri Burman from Globeson Business School. My question is that when I, Mr. Vineet Agarwal, when I have looked for, it's only about TCI and what are the achievements you have made. So I just want to know, what are the contribution and support you have received from your family to become Mr. Vineet Agarwal, what you are today?
Thanks. So I think you cannot be successful, and what you heard Aman and Ayan say as well, you know, your parents are people who are the most encouraging and who are at the background in terms of influencing you as much as possible. And that's true with me as well. I've been very fortunate to have a great family, which is not just my immediate family, but my cousins and brothers and sisters, and then my family once I got married, which was about a long time ago, and of course now the kids. So I learn a lot from everyone, and they've been very supportive. So my wife is traveling right now. She left on Sunday, and yesterday I came to Calcutta, and this evening I'm going to Bombay, and I'm going to return on Thursday, and my wife's going to get return tomorrow. So our kids are 12 and 8, and they are with their grandparents. So we can do this because they are there, and they help us through this journey. They're helping us through this journey. So they've always been very supporting. My dad has always told me, take those risks that I have to. And I said, don't say no to anything, because you will learn on a lot of fronts about a lot of things. I don't know if that answers it completely or...
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Proshanjit Das from Globeson Business School. My question is, what is the impact of this, what is the impact of this GST in logistics in India? That is actually my question.
So it's a very big question, and it will have
a lot of answers around it, but the simple solution, simple answer to this is that it will simplify the tax system in the country. So, and we know that. And once it simplifies the tax system in the country, it will help in simplifying logistics in the country. Because a lot of the logistics is essentially based on tax reasons. So, once it simplifies the logistics system in the country, it will help to move things faster, it will help to reduce cost of certain items in the system. I'll give you an example. Today, the average speed of a truck in India is about 31 kilometers per hour. And imagine if this goes up by 30%, which means it's 40 kilometers per hour. But it's 30% improvement, imagine. So that something like that could really impact, let's say, how fast you get your cargo, how fast you order, when you order something, how fast can you get it, even just the efficiency of a country as a whole. So GST is a very critical aspect of how India should be doing business. And if we as a nation have to be competitive, we have to implement something like a GST. It, in its current form, it's not necessarily the best thing, but it will evolve. It will be something the next 3-4 years after it is implemented, one of the best things that will happen to our country. The first few years is going to be very tough. But once it does happen, it will really transform our country.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Neha Singh, and I am from Globson Business School. So my question to you is, like, you are trying to contribute to the society through your foundation. So how it has influenced your success, and how you think we, as a youngster, can contribute to the society in a small way?
So after some time of actually working, you realize that there's something missing. And the missing part is, what am I giving back and how am I giving back? So I've been, again, very fortunate from my family's perspective. My grandfather, once he started the business, when he made a little money, very little money, he migrated from a very rural village in Rajasthan. And he moved to the chai bagans in Assam. And there he used to cycle about 10-15 kilometers a day, buying stuff from the market and selling it to the people in the tea estates. That's why he made a little bit money, and then he came to Calcutta and he started the transportation business. But he was extremely poor that time, and but he said that I have to give back. And once he made his little money, he went back and started giving, he started building schools. In Rajasthan, there was a problem of water, so he started doing that. And we as a family have been involved in that since then. So as a child, when I've been growing up, I've been going to villages, to places where we're doing social activities. And then when I personally got involved into the business, I got into a lot of it, which was I talked about the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the work that we do in the villages to educate girl child as well as even improve sanitation. So all that, and now we're doing a lot of work in the vocational education sector as well. So, as a family, we are very involved in it, and that has shaped me personally, because I can actually feel that I am doing something more than just making a business. And that is always on the back of my mind, that if you're making money, I can give that money. So we have a policy in the company that we will give out approximately 5 to 10% of our income, of the profits that we generate. So we are mandated by the government to give 2%, but we give between 5 and 10%. So it's now a fundamental part of our lives. And now our kids are also involved. So some of you are from Anant here, who've been... So my kids have given their pocket money to Anant, for example. And so that they feel that, yes, we want to also give back.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Niharika. Sir, as you mentioned, that you just don't do your business, but you're involved in so many things like reading, marathon, and so many things. But as student, I just want to ask you that, how do you manage your time? Like, You have your family business to see. You have so many other hobbies to see. How do you manage your time?
So time is how you prioritize your life. What is the most important priority in your life? And how you can prioritize it. So for me, the most important priority is family. So when I look at that and say that, how do I build things around where I can spend more time with my family? So I will ensure that I'm home at a certain time, try to at least put the kids to bed, maybe then get on to a few conference calls, and maybe check my emails. Early morning, I try to wake up by 5:45, 6 and do my running or just try to keep fit. And then travel. I travel about close to 12 to 15 days in a month. The idea is, again, prioritization. You have to find time for everything, but you have to find time to do certain things. You shouldn't be doing certain things. So one fine day, I decided I will cut out these 3-4 magazines that I read from my system, because it was not adding value, and I added some other magazines. So you have to constantly, what I talked about, change constantly. So continuously keep looking at your own self, look at it from outside, so that's a self-awareness, and see, okay, what is this person? Who is this person? What is that person doing? Can that person do things better? And so I think it's, I don't believe that you have to have a work-life balance specifically, there's nothing like that. When you are at work, you have to give 100% to your work. And when you are at living your life or you are playing, you have to give 100% to that. You cannot be thinking of either or when you are doing either or.
Thank you, sir.
Right. No, I think in Bengal, time management is always a question, Vineet. And, you know, and, because somewhere I read a quote and just kind of reinforcing what you said is... wanted to share with each one of you out here that if you ever want a work to be done, give it to a busy person and not to a non-busy person. He'll find some time to do it. You know, and in Bengal, we see many places, a lot of people who are completely idle and free and yet no work gets done because they don't have the time to do work. So I think that's the key to your question as we move on to the other flank now. And we can start from you. You, ma'am. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question to you was that we know the merits of success. What are the demerits of it?
Okay, so demerits of success could be that you, one could get sometimes blinded by that success. So you could feel that, oh, I'm doing everything right. I'm the god and my kids, what song they listen to, which is something. So that means that you feel that you can do everything. And that's where you, that's the reason for your downfall as well. So that's one of the demerits for success. The second is your time gets pulled in all directions from many, many places. So you have to be a little cognizant of how you want to manage it. Sometimes you want to not do things just for the sake of doing it. And I think these are the main things. So you tend to get swayed by success a lot. And then you have to take a pause and then you have to always go back to your roots and to your value system and say, is this what I want? And many times you'll find, no, it's not.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Siddharth Agarwal. Sir, my question is, as people say that it's easy to join your family business, is it that easy? And what were the challenges that you faced during this phase of turning one office to 1,400 offices?
How many of you are from family businesses here? Okay, wow. So a lot of people. So it's very tough to join a family business, though it's very easy to join it also. So it's a contradictory statement because the expectations from you are quite high once you join the business. So when I joined the business straight from the US, is ladke ko kya aata hai? Ye to US se padh ke aaya hai, isko to kuch malum hi nahi. What will he do? So very normal, very expected. So the expectations become high. But the way to prove that, change that, is to actually put your head down and work. Just keep doing it nonstop, day in, day out. Don't worry that, you know, tomorrow I'm going to be this or that or where I'm going to get to, but just keep doing it. So that 9 months to a year that I spent on the field, I know that a lot of my colleagues gained, changed their idea about me. They realized that I'm willing to learn, I'm willing to not be the boss's son. So I'm staying in the same places that they are, meeting the same food, I'm traveling in the same car, or I'm traveling in the train or buses or whatever. So it's the that influenced a lot of the thinking. So it's tough to be enough. So that has a lot of impact on you because that changes the way that you've been brought up. And that's great. That's how you should be challenged. And your second part was?
So what were the challenges that you faced?
Yeah. So that was one of the challenges were people undermining you, that what can this person do? The second was changing the mindset about people because a lot of people from my grandfather's generation in the company. How do I change the mindset? So again, respect your elders. You heard that from previous speakers. I believe that very fundamentally. So every single senior person in my organization, I had deep respect. I have deep respect. And I showed them that respect because they had contributed so immensely to the company and to the business. And so changing their mindset was tough. A lot of them, for example, did not know. I think in 1996, when I came back from the US, emails were just getting introduced. And a lot of the senior people didn't want to adapt it. So they said, nahin, ye email kya, hum toh, we're going to send letters, we're going to send telexes, telegrams. You guys probably don't even know what telexes are. But we changed that mindset. How did we change it? We said, theek hai, you want to read, you don't want to work on the computer. Why don't you take a printout of the email? Start by that. So people started reading the emails via printout and then started responding on that. Slowly we changed the culture. In a year or so, everyone was using emails. So respect them and also help them change their mindset. So these were the two challenges. And thirdly, the whole profile of the business. Now, what do you think of a company that is into transportation? What's the first thing that comes into your mind? Anyone? You think of a truck driver, Sadarji, in a dhoti lungi? Yeah? So that is what was perceived of a transportation company in 1996. And that's the mindset I wanted to change. I said, no, that's not how it is. So we changed that by saying, look, you have to wear a tie when you're going to somewhere outside because people will see that it is not a dhoti lungi company. So again, that was a mindset change. And internal mindset first and then external mindset. So that was another big challenge in the business.
Thank you so much, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my name is Radhika Karwa. And I want to ask, sir, being from a Marwadi family, sir, it is the mindset that a Marwadi family has is that the son has to join the family business. That's the way it is believed. So was it like your choice to join this business or like was it like your parents wanted you to join this business and take it forward?
Yeah, so our family is a little bit contrary to the regular Marwadi families to some extent. I can share by very specific examples. One of my uncles is actually a doctor. So he's a doctor by education. In fact, he went to college here in Calcutta. He did his he's a medical doctor. And then he started an institute in Jaipur called the Indian Institute of Health Management and Research. In my generation, I was not expected to do, my father told me you can do whatever you want. But then when I was in the US in the 90s, I realized that the potential of India is so untapped. We as a country are not coming up to our potential. And the way that I could contribute is through the business that is already there. Firstly, I'll change the business and then can I help that to change whatever I can in my own way to change the country. We had a great legacy as a company. You know, the first, almost all the major projects that were built in the country, from the Bhakra Nangal Dam to whatever you see as the temples of modern India, these were, we were involved in the transportation somewhere or the other. When the first nuclear bomb was exploded in Pokhran, we actually carried material for the government. We didn't know where it was going. It was top secret, but we were asked to transport that material. Even today, we transport currency for the RBI, coins and notes, and even some missile equipment and other things which are top secret. So I realized that as a company, we have that, we have a great brand in with people, with almost all levels of society. How can I leverage that more? So I saw that as a potential, and not that I could do something else. If you ask me what I would do otherwise, if I wouldn't be running a family business, maybe a writer.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Amit Yadav, and I'm from IIST Shippur. And my question to you is, you had an illustrious career, and we all know about your success. But there are failures, too. So at difficult times, how do you motivate yourself, and what would be your advice to us, to the younger generation, to keep motivated and going on?
Yeah, so it is... you have a lot of failure. Everyone will go through failures. Let's not. I talked about that in my speech. And the failures could be in your professional life. The failures could be in your personal life. You could be heartbroken. You could lose your job. You could be. So there could be lots of things. And that's where you will have to dig deep into your value system that I talked about. And that self-awareness. So that diary that you should maintain about yourself, about your SWOT analysis, and about your value system. Keep revisiting that. Because that's the only way that you will come out of it. And then there's the family. The family will always help you. They will always be with you. You know, sometimes families are also a cause of some of that, of those issues. But you also have to look beyond that. You have to look that how can they be, they can help me through that. So personally, I think... in the business, we've of course gone through several setbacks, but that has always encouraged us to take better steps, to plan better. I can share an example. In 1999, we formed a joint venture in Bangalore with a Japanese company, and this was to handle the logistics of Toyota. So anything that you see related to Toyota in India in terms of logistics is handled by our company. The parts movement, the car movement, everything related to Toyota is handled by us. That's the back-end logistics. So when we started that company in 1999, I was 25 years old, 24, 25, and I became the chairman of that company. My father encouraged me. He said, you should become the chairman. You should take that responsibility. And the first year that we started the company, we lost heavily. In fact, to that extent that in the first 2 years, we almost wiped out the complete equity of the company, the complete money that both partners had contributed. So it was a huge setback for me. I had just started working and I realized, you know, what a big failure I am. But then I changed my mindset. I looked deep and said, what can I do? So I went and parked myself in Japan for almost a month. I said, I'm going to talk to the Toyota guys there. I'm going to talk to my partners. And we will transform this company. We will get whatever changes we need to do from Japan. And then I parked myself in Bangalore in the joint venture company and said, we will make the turnaround happen. And we did. And in the last 17 years, it's one of the most successful logistics companies in that space today and very profitable also.
Yeah. So thank you so much to the panelists for your questions. I think they were brilliant and quite, I would say, kind of brought out some insights which beyond the speech that he shared with us. And before I move on to the auditorium, maybe that one question which is pertinent to all of them, Vineet, is sooner or later they will be vying in the job market, right? Yeah. And there will be, and in that, more often not than not, we as employers see that knowledge is often at par. Five candidates are there, pretty much knowledge is not a differentiator anymore. So what are the stuff that you as an employer look into the candidates when they come in to feel that, okay, this guy is employable and their employability goes up, or I would say your criteria in selecting a candidate for your organization, assuming knowledge is at par amongst five people, what are the things that they need to, you know, work on or keep in mind when they go off for jobs?
Yeah, so again, what I just talked about, be authentic. You cannot start pretending that, first, you know, forget about the knowledge part, but you cannot pretend. Because employers see through that. They always see that, yes, you know, what this guy is or girl is trying to say or really. The second is think long term. Do not think of this as a one-time job that, you know, I'm going to use this job, step up and take another job, step up, take another job. No, that's not going to work. Because today, if I'm hiring someone, let's say after 10 years of someone who started their career, and I see this person change five jobs, I'm not going to even touch the resume. Because that's not what the kind of person I'm looking at. If you want a change in the job, I will give you that. You ask the in the company that, no, I'm getting bored with doing this. Can I do something else? Yes, we will find. There's lots of things, thousands and thousands of things that you can do in the company. Different ideas, different stuff to do. But do not look at just that stepping stone, just very long term, just very short term. So that's the other thing that is to be projected, I feel, is important. Essentially, you know, ultimately your value systems. It will start reflecting in your behavior at some point in time. The way that you sit, the way that you talk, the way that you make eye contact, the way that you respond to questions, they all are a true reflection of your value systems.
Thank you so much. Hello. Yeah, and that brings us back to probably the points that you made at the very beginning about, you know, your self-awareness and ability to constantly learn and change. And we in India, and particularly, again, it's just an observation, not an aspersion. But as I said, the post-millennial or the newer generation seems to be always in a hurry, right? And they are always unhappy. And we say it's a Mamata Banerjee syndrome. No matter what happens, you're unhappy, you know, you're out there to protest in some form or the other. But I think the key is patience, key is focus, key is to believe in your value system and kind of move forward. And we kind of keep going from there. So on that note, I'll just now open it for a couple of questions, maybe three to four questions max, depending on how long the questions are. Keep it short, keep it pointed. So raise your hand, whoever I can see first. Yeah, I can see that gentleman first, and then I come to you.
And if you don't have questions, I can ask you questions.
Yeah. So that's a good incentive for you to ask. So yeah, we can carry the mics.
A very good afternoon, sir. My name is Ravidej Monga. And sir, my question to you is, what's the next big thing you think about logistics? It's coming up. As you saw, supply chain was long way back. So what's the next thing you think is a major change coming up for India?
Please sit down. You know, supply chain solutions is a big word, and it encompasses a lot of things. You'll see small things happening in logistics across the world, and you keep hearing about it. You heard about drones, because, you know, eventually sometimes some kind of drone deliveries will start. You've heard about self-driving cars, so there'll be self-driving trucks, autonomous trucks that can come in. You've data analytics, huge amount of work that's happening on data analytics in logistics. How can it be more predictive? Versus just prescriptive. So in terms of, for example, you are you constantly want your, let's say, a book that you order only between 8 and 9 p.m. in the evening because you are home at that time. And that's how the logistics system at the back end will also configure. That's all data analytics. So a lot of small things are happening across the world, across the country in logistics, and that will start reflecting here as well. So every question you ask me, I'm going to ask you also a question. Is that okay? So how many of you, given that there's Uber and Ola and all these ride sharing, taxi sharing services, will not buy a car when you can afford one? I can see only one person, two. So you'll not buy a car. You know, the entire story that Uber and others tell us that none of the younger guys are ever going to buy cars. But this is very contrary to that. It seems only everyone is going to buy a car, right? Okay. Next question.
Okay. So next, there was a hand there somewhere. And I'll then come up in case there's a question. Yeah. So the lady out there. Can you take the mic there? Yeah.
Hello, sir. My name is Shruti Shah and I'm from Globson Business School.
Just speak into the mic. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
So my name is Shruti Shah and I'm from Globson Business School. So my question to you is, like, often we see that our style of doing things differs from our parents. And as you join your family business, was there anything like your style of doing things were different from your parents, and your parents opposed you something? And if there was something, how did you cope up with that?
Yeah, so again, there's always something. No relationship is perfect. And so when I joined the business, my father, of course, expected me to do things in a certain way. I did not necessarily do it that way. So I was always respectful of that. I never said that I'm going to do it my way only and this and that. I used to always reason it out with him. Please sit up, please. So some things always are there. It is not that it is simple. It's not going to be a cakewalk. It's not going to be even the other side of that is going to be extremely tough. But you can find a balance. And that balance is by actually having very frank conversations. And actually really explaining logic. Logic is what works. Emotion, bringing emotions into that, into the business, does not work. Because the moment you start saying, "Main aisa karunga," or "I can do this," that's emotions. You have to look at logic. And I think all parents are understanding from that perspective. At least my parents are.
Yep.
So, you know, you my
should,
question?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm just telling you that you should also repeat this question to Cyrus Mystery someday. Right?
So my question is that how many of you are not on Facebook? One. Two. Anyone? I can see one person there who's not on Facebook. Okay.
Hello. Yeah. Anyone from the top half wants to make a question? I'll see, go down. Yeah, there is one gentleman there up there.
Lady.
Oh, sorry, lady. I couldn't. The light is too dazzling. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is to Mr. Mukherjee, who is a proud alumnus of our ISWBM. I'm Payal Sarkar from ISWBM. So my question is, that I'm pursuing my MBA course, so how can I make myself industry ready? Apart from pursuing my academics, what else can make me ready for the industry, and how can I groom myself?
No, Payal, though I stand flattered, but today the speaker is Vineet, so we can have an offline conversation on this, but I think this question I asked him a while back, you know, at the end of it, that how do you make yourself industry ready, to which I think he answered. About, you know, be authentic in what you did. If I may just repeat, Vineet, what you
please,
said,
yeah.
That being to be authentic in whatever you pursue and bring that onto the board. You know, industry ready is about, you know, cracking your first job. After that, the industry will get you ready. To be very honest, there is no such thing as industry ready. You'll never be ready for any industry till you actually get into one. So to get into that industry, I think I couldn't agree more with Vineet. And more often than not, as employers, we see that people come and try and pretend of knowing things which they don't, of doing things that they don't, and you know, kind of even claiming skills that they don't have. So I think the more authentic you are, if we are very convinced that you know your strengths and you know your improvement areas, we have a lot more confidence in you. We like people who are, I would say, more generally aware about things that are happening in the world beyond just the books that you have read. And more, and the most biggest thing, which obviously very few people have, is common sense and ability to apply, you know, and being street smart. These are a couple of things, I think, which helps you in any industry and able to take decisions at a time when you need to take a decision. And I think that's what Vineet said, that if you constantly in his speech, if you're looking at, you know, constant learning mode, and not to say that, okay, I've done my MBA, so I'm done with it. I don't need to learn anything more about management. I know pretty much everything. But it's actually what you read after your MBA schools are over. If you constantly keep on reading and learning And that will help you change your mindset, and that will make your mind more disciplined. I'm just taking excerpts of his speech, and it's very well summarized. I think if you follow those three, I think this session is a success and your life will be one.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Payal. Anyone else?
My question.
Yeah, your question.
Do you prefer to read with a physical book, or do you prefer to read digitally? Be it, you know, be an iPad, Kindle, or a phone. So one second. So if you prefer to read through a physical book or physical paper, newspaper, whatever, please raise your hands. That's okay. I don't think I need to raise.
So Telegraph still has a future, you know, all of your.
So I think this is possibly the difference between what you said about the Generation Z. I think there's another generation, like my kids, our generation, I don't know, A perhaps,
Z now plus
if you go through the circle.
Yeah.
So they don't prefer, yeah. I mean, I know my boys love to read physical books, but they also like, they're digital natives. So for them, it's a regular thing. And I have two small nieces who are two years old. And when you give them a physical book, they're trying to do this to it. So it's... it's like they think everything is digital because they're so used to using iPads, etc.
Absolutely. Yeah. Any other question? Yeah, down there. So after this, we'll take one more because we need to wrap it up. He has also a flight to catch. So yeah, after this, we'll take one more. Yeah.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Sutanvi Ghosh from Globes and Business School. I have a general question. Like, till now in life, what is the most challenging thing you have faced? How did you overcome it? And how do you handle criticism in general?
So I can answer the second part a little easily, which is how do you handle criticism? The highest number of criticism critical statements I receive is from my wife. So you don't do this, you don't do that, where are you, and so on and so forth. And I handle that. I'm here, fortunately, and still all my bones are in place. So the handle that is that we have to get into the other person's shoes. Clearly, you have to see that what is she feeling? Why is she feeling that? And how can I help her in that process? And it's not so simple because men think men are from Mars, women are from Venus. So, but we try. And so it's building that open communication related to how... So I'm getting into the different league now, actually, not from criticism, but to how to handle marriages. But really speaking, it's even with anyone who's giving you any criticism, you need to understand what that person is, be in that person's shoes and see that how can you help that person realize that, firstly, you have to realize yourself, you know, analyze that aspect. And then you have to get into that other person's shoes and try to reconcile. The first part of the question was... most challenging thing that I've encountered, I would say actually finishing the marathon. The 42K was a killer. So I remember at the middle of it at 30-ish kilometers, a friend and I were running. And he said, you know, let's go back. And I said, what? What did you mean? Let's go back. We have to finish this. He said, no, let's go back. I also thought, haha, let's go back. What difference does it make? We'll do it next time. Then somehow I felt that we have to do it. I'll walk it or do whatever, but we have to finish the race. Even if I have to crawl or whatever. But and after some time, the race, it was, we had crossed 4 hours of running. And the track that they had maintained, which was in Gurgaon somewhere, they opened it to traffic. So we were actually dodging trucks, etc. also simultaneously. It became an obstacle course as well. But it was extremely challenging. And I think I dug deeper than anything possible that day to finish that race.
Thank you, sir.
Is there anybody at the top? I'll come back to you if there's none. Or I'll allow you one more last. Yeah. Anyone from there? No.
My question?
Yeah, you can meanwhile ask your question. Yeah, okay. So we'll come back to you after your question. Okay.
How many of you have 5 email accounts? Why?
5. You know, there's a surveillance agency guy also sitting here somewhere. So now there's multiple email accounts.
So, sorry, I'd rather ask another. How many of you want to live and work outside India?
Wow. So, make it in India has a lot to think. Right. So, we can go back to that lady there at the back. Yeah. So, anybody can give her a microphone, please? Right at the back row. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Pooja. I am from NSHM. And my question is, who is your role model? And what things which inspire you and you also have execute in your real life, in your business journey?
Thank you. Please sit down. So,
thank you.
My role model is, one of my role models is clearly my father. I've seen him go through a lot. For example, in around the time when I came back from the US, at that time my father and his brothers were going through a family split, and I saw the tremendous courage that he put forward in not only salvaging the business and also continuously encouraging us to grow the business rapidly. So I thought that was exemplary in his character and behavior and attitude. And that's a great role model for me. So, and I think everyone needs to have more than one role model, because you have role models for certain things, but there are role models for certain other things. So for different things, I have different people I look up to.
Right. I think we'll just close the session on this note, because it's a very, very interesting question to finish with. Because honestly, it was a pleasure listening to you, Vineet, and I think the crisp and very pertinent points you have left with us will at least inspire a lot of us in this audience to walk the rest of the journey of our life. I'd like to also thank each one of you for making your, making some time, as this lady asked. In spite of your schedules, academic pressures, you made time to come here all the way. Many of you are from outside IIM, so you would have made quite a journey to come here and listen to us. And a big thank you to Aima also for providing the forum and the opportunity to both of us interact with each and every one of you, and the sponsors for supporting this event in the way they did. And I'd like to hand it over back now to close the session.
Thank you, Mr. Agarwal, for sharing your thoughts with us. May I now request Mr. Dhruba Mukherjee to present a memento to Mr. Vineet Agarwal. Thank you. I now request Mr. Gautam Ray, President CMA, to present a memento to Mr. Dhruba Mukherjee. With this, we come to the end of the second session.